Good evening, Evangelical Presbyterian Church. It is great to see you. My name is Sandy Willson. In case it's not obvious, I'm old. I retired from Second Presbyterian Church 7 years ago, very happily, seeing Dr. George Robertson succeed me in the senior ministry role there. I've served as some interim pastorates since then, and currently I'm serving as the interim president for the Gospel Coalition. That word interim is very important. I want to assure those of you who love the Gospel Coalition, we will find a qualified president very soon. But it's a joy to serve them in the interim, and it's great to be here with you tonight. Those of you who have spent your time in committee meetings and in the first part of the assembly, you get a special reward for coming back to be here tonight. Your reward is you get 3 more years of service in the EPC. So congratulate yourselves. We're really glad that you're here, and especially to talk about such an important topic. I was asked to preach tonight on the topic of racial justice and racial harmony. I'm sure one reason is that you have an important paper to consider tomorrow, and it's probably good for all of us to tune our hearts to this theme under the Lord Jesus Christ on the eve of such a consideration. And I'm glad that you are considering it, or we are considering it, and praying for the outcome to be one that honors the Lord. When you think about any aspect of the Christian ethic, you want to think about how you want to perform, how you want to behave, how you want to conduct yourself in the presence of God. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we want to see things here as they will be in the new heaven, new earth. We know that we'll not quite get there completely until Jesus returns, but our task is to pursue that great ambition. In order to do that, I can't think of a book of the Bible that would be better to turn to than Paul's letter to the Ephesians. So if you'll scroll there or turn there with me to Ephesians chapter 2, while you're turning, let me give you a little background. The reason this book is so helpful is that Paul is urging the Ephesian Christians to live like real disciples of Jesus, to do so under the banner of God's sovereign love, to do so in coram Deo, in the presence of God, very self-consciously being in his presence. And so from the very beginning, Paul speaks saying that blessed be the name of our God and Father, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us from the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing. From the heavenly realms in every spiritual blessing. And we'll find that reference to the heavenly realms 5 or 6 times in Paul's letter to the Ephesians. What he's doing is he's elevating our vision so that we're looking not just from 30,000 feet, but looking from God's perspective on everything. And of course, you know quite well that he begins the letter by showing us how God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are working together in harmony as one God, 3 persons, to accomplish this great purpose of God, our redemption. Now, our redemption faces some major obstacles. First of all, our Savior died on a cross. It's tough when your leader is dead. Secondly, we are dead. And you find in Ephesians chapter 1, after we're introduced to the work of the Trinity, Paul shows us how Christ has been raised from the dead and exalted to the highest place in the spiritual places. So he is ruling from the dominion of God himself. So that problem's solved. And then secondly, when you get to Ephesians 2, he says, you were dead in trespasses and sins, but now God has raised you up and seated you positionally at the right hand of the Father. So that problem is solved. And then when we come to verses 11 through 22, he addresses the third major obstacle to our redemption. And that is, we don't like each other very much. So we're alienated from God. We're also alienated from one another. That's the plight of sinful men and women. And so we're going to see in our text how God addresses this third major obstacle and triumphs over it through his work of redemption. This letter is quite magnificent. Samuel Taylor Coleridge said of it, it is the divinest composition of man. One scholar just simply calls it transcendent wonder. It was Calvin's favorite epistle. I don't know if it's right to have a favorite epistle, but Calvin did, and this was it. And I think my favorite comment was from the old president of Princeton Seminary in the middle of the 20th century, John Mackay. And he said, Ephesians is doctrine put to music. And that's exactly what it is. Let's stand together, if you would, and let's pray together, and then we'll read these verses together and study them. Let's pray together. Father, we assemble in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the one you have appointed as Prince of Israel, of your church. And we confess it is all about Jesus, as we've been singing this evening. And we pray that our hearts will be all about Jesus in this time together. We pray that this assembly will be all about Jesus. We pray that all of our churches, all of our elders and pastors, all of our elders' wives, all of our congregations will be all about Jesus. Speak, O Lord, for your servants listen. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11. Hear the word of God. Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God, by the Spirit. All flesh is like grass. All of its glory is like the flower of the field. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Amen. Please be seated. Please notice the literary structure of the text. With your Bibles open before you, you'll see, first of all, in verse 11, the word therefore. That means, of course, that we should ask, what's therefore? And this text is building upon the previous text, as we've always already noted. Then look in verse 13, and you see the words, but now. Obviously, that's a division, a literary division in the text. And so our second observation will come from those verses. And then look at verse 19. You have the words, so then, which leads us into another major idea. So let's look at it this way. I want to tell you what we're going to do before we do it, kind of like they do in the army. First of all, in verses 11 and 12, we are going to see that we must remember our lamentable story. Paul's going to take us back to our pre-Christian behavior and habits and cultures. So first of all, in verses 11 and 12, we must remember our lamentable story. When you get to verse 13, beginning with the words, but now, all the way through 18, We're going to notice there that we must, secondly, receive our lavish salvation, and lavish it is. And we'll examine why we say that in just a few moments. And then thirdly, when you get to verses 19 through 22, beginning with "so then," a new section, I think Paul is showing us that we must revitalize our loving society. We've been brought into a new society, and we are to embrace it, to engage it, to promote it, to participate in it. We are to be the leaders as elders and elders' wives, primarily here in this room, who revitalize this loving community that has been created for us by the living God. Well, let's go then to the first two verses, verses 11 and 12, and we see that we must remember our lamentable story. Why do I say that? Well, look clearly in verses 11 and 12, some of the first words in those verses. Remember, you get the word "remember" twice there. Why? The reason Paul is taking us back to remember is that remembering our past is useful. It's the purpose of lament. And as you know, you get many psalms that are psalms of lament. You get the book of Lamentations, which is a lament. There are many portions of Scripture that are about lament. And Paul here is leading us in a lament about what we were like before Christ took hold of us as Jews and Gentiles. And why would we lament? Well, here's what's true about racial justice in the U.S. or anywhere else on the planet, including the first century in the Mediterranean area. That is, as some scholars say, what you don't reveal, you don't heal. It's just like these wicked family secrets we have. When they don't come out in the open, we don't deal with them, they don't find healing. You pastors know, when people will not be honest about what they've been through and what their pains and agonies have been, the brokenness and sin and oppression that they've experienced, there will be no healing for them if they're not encouraged to articulate it. So Paul articulates it. And here he is speaking about the Jew and Gentile relationship. And you know very well that that was a troubled relationship. William Barclay puts it this way. He says, "The Jew had an immense contempt for the Gentile. The Gentiles," said the Jews, "were created by God to be fuel for the fires of hell. God," they said, "loves only Israel of all the nations that he had made. It was not even lawful to render help to a Gentile mother in her hour of sorest need, for that would simply be to bring another Gentile into the world." That's the kind of relationship the Jews and Gentiles had. It was utterly, mutually contemptible. So the Jews used the D word to describe Gentiles, which would be every bit as offensive as the N word today. They called them dogs, which was the worst thing you could call anyone. That was the nature of the relationship. Total mutual contempt. So Paul here in verse 12 gives us what John Stott calls a five-fold alienation. Look at it in the verse. First of all, the Gentiles are separated from Christ. Secondly, they're alienated from the commonwealth of Israel. They're alienated from the church. Thirdly, they're strangers to the covenants of promise. Imagine this, being a sinful human being and you have no covenant with the sovereign judge of the universe. Fourthly, they have no hope. And fifthly, and most importantly, they're without God in the world. That's called alienation. William Hendrickson summarizes it this way. He says, they are Christless, stateless, friendless, hopeless, and godless. So what about our own day? We need to think about it. We consider the strife among ethnic groups in our own experience. Certainly, we remember in the 1830s through the around 1850, at President Andrew Jackson's decree, we shipped about 60,000 Indians from their homeland, five major tribes. 16,000 of them died along the way, and some of you know the history of American revival among Native Americans. Many of those people were Christians. In fact, some of the reports on the Trail of Tears say that they stopped three times a day for the order of the day to worship God because they'd been taught that way by Presbyterian missionaries. one of the saddest moments of ethnic cleansing, brutal in our country's history. And then, of course, we have the internment of 120,000 Japanese people, men, women, and children in 10 camps during the World War II period, simply because of their ethnicity. And having spent some years in Boston, I remember back in the 70s when the Southies, the Irish, and those on the North End, the Italians, and then, of course, you throw in the African-Americans in Dorchester and Mattapan, and they would be throwing rocks at each other and broken bottles and causing all kinds of chaos. It's interesting, isn't it, that throughout the history of the world, we find ethnic groups at each other. But of course, what affects most of us most of the time in our thinking about our own setting is the unbelievable brutality of African Americans' heritage when 10 to 12 million people were put in ships and 2 million of them died of disease and starvation before they got here, living in indentured slavery 400 years ago. Before the very founding of our nation. And it has left us with an amazing problem and an issue to deal with even today. I remember when I came to Second Presbyterian Church in 1995, one of the first things that I did was to go to a sensitivity seminar. It consisted of about 20 African Americans and 20 white people like myself. And we got together and we had 6 lectures spread over about 3 months on different topics that had to do with racial harmony and racial justice. And in the meanwhile, we were matched one-on-one with a partner to have regular lunch with and have discussions about race issues. Well, I was not from West Tennessee. I grew up in East Tennessee. And so I just started where I knew to start. And my partner, I still love him to this day, African-American man who's about 4 inches taller than I am and about 50 pounds heavier, and his part-time job was repossessing cars. So he always packed heat, and he was working on his PhD in sociology. Some of you know who I'm talking about. And so we went to breakfast for our first meeting, and I said to him, well, brother, one thing we could do is suggest a book that each one of us would read, and then we can discuss the books together. So he said, fine, what would you suggest? And I'm too embarrassed to tell you what it was, but I suggested a book that I thought was good on race relations. And so we met again 2 weeks later for breakfast, and he didn't say anything about my book. And so finally I said, brother, did you have a chance to look at the book? And he said, yeah, I flushed it down the toilet. It was at that point that I decided I could either let my feelings be hurt or I could get an education. I'm thankful that I decided to get an education. So I began to read about the slave trade and indentured slavery in this country, to read about the Civil War and the great loss of human life because of our founders' tough decision that they made, the wrong decision, a century before. And I read about the Jim Crow era and life in the South. And I read about 4,400 documented lynchings in 12 Southern states, and other things about the Jim Crow era that helped me understand. I read more about the Civil Rights era. And what was most impressive to me among all the evils was the church's complicity at every point in our history. It raises the question that James Cone says is the big question of African-American theology, black theology. And black theology, he says, seeks to answer this question. How can a people who have been sold into slavery and abused for hundreds of years worship the same God as their abusive masters? That's the big problem that black theology, he says, seeks to deal with. And we Presbyterians have to remember our own history. In 1861, at the founding of the Southern Presbyterian Church, which was called the Presbyterian Church of the Confederate States of America at the point, in Augusta, Georgia, declared that the slave system in America had generally proven to be kind and benevolent, and had provided real effective discipline. And if you bring yourself all the way up to the 1920s and 1930s, our research shows that in the North alone, not in the South, but in the North, Ku Klux Klan membership is estimated to have been between 3 and 5 million people in the North. And the Klan claimed to have 40,000 ministers in its ranks. This is some of the darkest reality that we must remember if we're to look at our salvation and see what its implications are and examine from whence we've come. Well, you may say, well, that's history. Sure, I'm glad that's over. Glad in 1964, 65, we passed all the civil rights laws and that's behind us, but I think almost all of us would know better. I remember 30 years ago watching an ABC primetime by Diane Sawyer. Do some of you remember this? She recruited two young men, one who was white, his name was John, and one who was black, his name was Glenn. They both graduated from Big Ten universities. They both were from middle-class homes in the Midwest. And she convened them and brought them to St. Louis to just run an experiment. She didn't know how the experiment would come out. But these men would go to buy a car, to buy a pair of shoes, to rent an apartment, to look for a job. And there was a hidden camera watching the entire episode with both John, the white young white man, and Glenn, the young black man. And I think even John, as well as Diane Sawyer, were amazed at what they discovered. This is 30 years ago. That when they go to the shoe store, John, the young white man, comes to the counter, and the salesman immediately comes to him, shows him the shoes, tries to convince him to buy something. So he leaves. 15 minutes later, Glenn comes in, the young black man. He stands in the same place that John stood. And you can see in the back of the TV screen, the sales rep, he notices Glenn, but he turns the other way. And it's about 10 minutes before he finally comes over and serves Glenn. They go to buy a car. And John asks about the price of a car, a particular car, and how much the down payment would be, and the salesman says, oh, it would be nearly nothing. So he leaves, said, I'm going to think about it, and come back. 30 minutes later, Glenn comes, goes to the same car with precisely the same salesman, and says, what would the down payment be? He says, oh, it'd be about $5,000. They go to rent an apartment. John goes in, talks to the manager of the apartment complex, and he says, yes, we have an apartment available. Let me show it to you. He says, well, let me just think about it. I'm glad to know you've got an apartment. He leaves. 30 minutes later, Glenn comes, and the man tells him, sorry, we just don't have anything available. They go to apply for a job, and John is immediately given an application. And 30 minutes later, when Glenn comes in, they have no job openings. And the great irony at the end of the show, when Diane is saying goodbye to them in New York, they go out to the streets of New York and both together are hailing a cab. Glenn is there and John is here, and the cabbie goes right past Glenn and comes and picks up John. It's really quite stunning. You say, well, that was 30 years ago. Sure, I'm glad that we've had so much progress in the recent years. Well, what if we had an example just 10 years ago where you had a young black man and a young white man in their teens learning to drive. They're from the same family because the black young black man is adopted. Well, we actually have a case like that, and their daddy is sitting right over there. It's Dr. Dean Weaver. If you know Dean's story with all the ministry that he and his church had in Sierra Leone, they adopted two Sierra Leone children who were siblings, and a daughter from the West Indies, and another son from Cleveland, Ohio, an African American, along with three natural children. That's called a busy life. So let me talk about these for just a moment. Jacob was a good kid, and he eventually served our country in the U.S. Marines. He's white. He's one of their natural children. Here's his early driving experience, his first few years. Jacob was stopped by the police 4 times. Every case, he got a ticket. And Dr. Weaver says he deserved it. So, no question. Stopped 4 times. Every time was for a violation, and he got a ticket and deserved it. And then you've got Isaac Weaver. He also is a good kid. He's African. He was a great high school football player on a state championship team. He was enormously popular, a responsible kid. He's black. By the same police department, having grown up in the same family, he was stopped 12 times, never received a ticket, because he never violated any laws. So why was he stopped? You tell me. And of course we know there are many researchers who seek to tell us about our current racial injustices, and sometimes they're not quite as careful with their statistics or their analyses that cause many of us to question their accuracy. But there's no question about it. When you do your research properly, you find a vast difference between the experience of African Americans and Anglo-Americans in this country. For example, blacks, whites, and Latinos violate the drug laws at similar rates. But black people are imprisoned and given longer sentences at an exponentially higher rate than whites. Pew Research Center shows that the black imprisonment rate is nearly twice the rate as those who are Hispanics, and more than 5 times the rate among whites. Here in Memphis, we who live here, and by the way, we welcome you to our fine city that we love deeply, but we're very aware of our racial injustices and racial disparities. For example, in the economic realm, Memphis proper, that's about 600,000 people, is 64% African American. But if I were to ask you, what do you think the percentage of business ownership is in Memphis proper by African Americans? You might guess 30%, 25%. No, it's 5%. You could say, well, there are lots of reasons for that. Yes, there are, and it'd be good for us to consider them. And certainly it's true that research has been done to figure out what difference it makes in about 30 different cities. If you apply for a job with the name Emily or Brad versus the names LaTanya or Jermaine, studies clearly show that those who are named Emily or Brad are welcomed into job application at much higher rates than LaTanya and Jermaine. Eric Mason, in his book, Woke Church, and you might not agree with everything Eric says, but I think it's an excellent book. Eric says this: white Christian leaders are able to see Hendiadys, dangling participles, Niphil stems in Hebrew, aorist passives. They can excavate archaeological finds of Hittite culture and frame the unknown alphabet, but are unable to see racism and injustice. Sometimes as a dominant race, we're just not able to see it. I remember some years ago, I had a delightful lunch with a friend of mine, another white pastor. We're similar age, and this would be maybe 15 years ago. And he said to me, Sandy, my parents immigrated here from Europe. They had nothing to do with the 19th century in America. Why would anybody blame them for racism? And why would we be responsible for any of this mess? And I simply said to him, brother, do you understand the privileges that you are now enjoying simply because you have white skin, which is coming at the cost of those who have black skin? He said, no, what are you talking about? And I cited some economic studies 15 years ago, mind you, that clearly showed that white skin over a lifetime is worth $1 million. That's what a multitude of economists have shown us. So Paul is simply saying, you need to remember, you need to assess your lamentable past as Jews and Gentiles, or wherever you may be in whatever century you're in. I was assisting a Presbyterian session not too long ago with a statement that they were considering on racial justice. They never had made a statement before. And one of the elders said, Pastor, I think we need to take a couple years to consider this. I mean, we don't need to be in a rush. One of the other elders said to him, you realize we're 60 years late. So I would maybe say that of us in the EPC. I'm so glad we're doing this, but let's get on with it. Now, secondly, notice that we not only must remember our story, our lamentable history, our lamentable story, but we must receive our lavish salvation. There are two keys to this in your text, and we don't have time to get into the weeds, and we won't, but he mentions union with Christ and the atonement of Christ. So if you'll look at the text, he says we are in Christ Jesus, but now in Christ Jesus, that's union with Christ. And then in the same verse later, he says, brought near by the blood of Christ. Those two themes take us through these verses. These are the two major benefits that are lavishly poured out on us. We not only have Christ walking with us or walking over us or walking in front of us, he's walking in us and we're walking in him. We are organically in him. It's just, it blows your mind to think about the implications of that. As we were singing earlier, he knows my name. And as we were singing, I was delighting myself in the fact that he does know my name, even though I forget it sometimes at my age. But I was also thinking, Sandy, he knows all their names. And especially when you're looking cross-culturally or multi-ethnically, he knows all their names. He cherishes them. They're in him. He's going to crown them one day. They're princes and princesses. So we are in union with Christ. And then look at the price that was paid for this, the very blood of the Lord Jesus Christ in the atonement. He shed his blood that the hostility between ethnic groups might be destroyed, killed, erased, so that the wall of hostility that was in the temple area, as you know, it is brought down, and there's no distinction now between Jew and Gentile, and between the ethnic groups, all by the blood of Jesus Christ. As our EPC proposed paper says, racism relativizes the atonement. And it does. It relativizes union with Christ, and it relativizes the atonement. And all for the purpose of being one man. He says, so that the two become one. What does he mean here? Well, I think we could go back to the second century and learn from Clement of Alexandria, who said, we who worship God in a new way as the third race are Christians. Third race. Some years ago at Second Presbyterian, we invited Dr. David Anderson, who's the pastor of a church in Columbia, Maryland. It's a diverse, multi-ethnic church. And he said, it's true. He said, if you really want to have a multi-ethnic church, both ethnic cultures have to give up their cultures and develop a third culture. And that's what so many people are not willing to do, sadly. Well, here we have it. We have a major problem, and we've got the solution. The miraculous solution of union with Christ and the blood of Jesus Christ to destroy the hostility. What are we doing with it? That's the problem. Let me remind you that today is Juneteenth, June 19th. And you know why we remember and celebrate this day. Well, because June the 19th, 1865, was a very important day. Here's what happened. The Emancipation Proclamation was formally pronounced by Lincoln on January the 1st, 1863. In April of 1865, Lee surrendered to Grant at Appomattox Courthouse. So here you have it. The Emancipation Proclamation declares that all slaves in Confederate states are free at the beginning of 1863. And in 1865, the South has surrendered. But in April and May and June of 1865, the slaves in Texas are still slaves. Why? They hadn't gotten the news. So what happens? 250,000 slaves are formally declared to be emancipated by General Gordon Granger on June the 19th in 1865. And so I, along with others, say, let's celebrate, let's participate, educate, advocate, innovate, agitate, renovate, supplicate, and integrate, and liberate. Let's enjoy Juneteenth. But you notice the problem. The foundation had been laid. The proclamation had been given. The war had been won, and they're still in slavery. It often happens, and it's happening even in our own day. Paul says that God came to preach peace. And when he preaches peace, things should be happening. The gospel should have impact on our lives and fundamentally in the church and then, of course, in society. Now, if you will, look at Ephesians chapter 1 and you can see why this is so important. It's because this great triune plan of redemption is seeking to fulfill the purpose of the triune God. And you get it in verse 9. Where Paul says, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time. Look at this, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. Here's the cosmic grand scheme of the triune God. To take the entire disparate cosmos, and especially the conflicts among those who are made in his own image, human beings, and to bring them in perfect unity at the feet of the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. That's the master plan. And that's the reason that this lesson in Ephesians 2 is so vital, not only for the first century, but for the 21st century. That's the plan. And you see it in Ephesians 4, the first mention of an ethical injunction based upon the great doctrines of chapters 1-3, make every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. Before he talks about sex or marriage or working place or lying or cheating or stealing, first thing he talks about is you must be active participants in the grand scheme of God to unite everything at his feet. So I have to ask, does your church look like Ephesians 2? Does your church represent your neighborhood? Those who are within driving or walking distance of your local church. If you did a demographic study of your neighborhood, would it parallel the demographic study in your church? If not, it at least would be a good question for the leaders to ask, why is that? I noticed when I came into Hope Presbyterian that the sign there, one of the banners said, you are welcome, but that's not all it said. You are welcome and you are wanted. And if you talk to Dr. Rufus Smith, you'll find out that that is a key theme here, to make everybody know you are welcomed and you're wanted. Is there serious conversation taking place in your church about these kinds of issues? Well, lastly, look at the last verses 19 through 22, and here we see that we must revitalize our loving society. Why do I say that? Because there are three images that are given here that are absolutely crucial for our success in obeying the Lord in his commandments in this text. You'll notice that in the EPC paper, it starts with a lament and it ends with hope. If you've studied lament in the scriptures, and you would know this from Mark Vrogop's book on lament, that biblical lament includes hope. It always includes hope. It always ends in hope. And so the Apostle Paul ends in hope. He starts with where we were. He shows us how he's changing us by his lavish salvation. And then he shows us what it looks like, where we're headed, what our future is. This is hope for us. My friend John Piper says, you know, I've spent a, and of course he's written on this topic and preached on it often. And he says, often I would start with lament, but he says, you know, I'm switching it now. He says, I start with hope when I look at this topic. He says, to quote him, Christian scripture portrays a stunning, radical, hope-filled, countercultural vision of how Christians are to treat persons of different ethnicities with love and justice in the pursuit of living peaceably with all so far as it depends on you. There is no greater vision of what humanity is called to be than the vision of what God is creating in Christ Jesus. You can hear him preaching that. Well, the first mandate is in the first symbol in verse 19a, where Paul says, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but fellow citizens with the saints. That is, we must treat each other as fellow citizens in the kingdom. We are keenly interested that every citizen be included in the commonwealth and that every citizen be treated justly. Some years ago, when you'll remember Philando Castile was shot by the Minneapolis police unjustly. And when that happened, it was midweek, as I remember, I just called Pastor Rufus Smith, my friend. I said, Rufus, what does a white pastor say on Sunday after something like that? And he said, give me 24 hours. And in 24 hours, he had convened or called for a meeting of 400 pastors, about half black, half white. There were also Hispanics involved, just to come together to pray. That eventually led to the Memphis Christian Pastors Network, MCPN. And of course, we convinced Rufus to be the president of the organization. He wasn't going to get out of that. And one of our first things to say was this: those of us who are in the suburbs, who are dominantly white, want to say to those of you in the urban area, if one of your young men or young women is brutalized by police or treated unfairly, let us investigate that in a proper way with you. And when we find that that has been the case, we will join together with you and we'll be at City Hall together with you. So we're fellow citizens. We're going to be brothers and sisters in the kingdom. We're going to stand up for each other. The EPC paper calls it kingdom harmony, and I like that. Are you thinking about equal citizenship for everyone in the kingdom? Some years ago, Second Presbyterian decided to help a school that was nearby. Many churches are doing that now. This was some years ago. And we began to help some of the young children read. The school was 40% African-American, 40% Hispanic, 20% other, 90% on the federal lunch program, so impoverished area. And mostly it was our senior women, not solely, but mostly senior women who went to help in these reading groups. And that little school's reading scores, the TCAP scores, began to do like this. In Memphis, whenever you see school scores going up, you know, one of two things has happened. Either that principal is doing something fantastic, or they're cheating like crazy. So Dr. Sam Shaw, the principal of that school, got many phone calls, and they said, Dr. Shaw, what in the world is happening at Berkeley School? And here was his answer. He said, I don't know for sure, but I think it has something to do with Jesus. Indeed, it does. We treat each other as fellow citizens of the kingdom of God. Secondly, we are members, we treat each other as equal members of his family. You see this even in the Pentateuch, where Moses is clear to show Israel that Joseph tried to retain only Benjamin and send all brothers back to Judea. And God trumped him and didn't let him keep just Benjamin. And that's the reason Joseph broke down sobbing. He realized that God's grace was greater than his grace. And Moses was teaching the children of Israel, you cannot be tribal. You cannot separate yourselves from one another. Joseph tried that, and God didn't let him, and it's not allowed. Same thing with us. So the early church was multi-ethnic, and our churches should represent the ethnic diversity of our neighborhoods because we treat each other as members of his family. And thirdly, the third symbol is a beautiful one. It is that we must treat each other as fellow residents in his temple. Ed Stetzer once said, American churches like the idea of diversity. They just don't like being around different people. That's our problem. And what Paul is saying, you've got to. It is a gospel issue. Because the gospel raises you up from death. It also raises up these relationships from death and makes them family relationships. Think about that. What's a marriage like? What's a family like? Here you get it. And so we have to ask ourselves, do we realize that when we're in the church, we are God's dwelling place? That this is his house? That God is the Father, Jesus is our older brother? That they want all the siblings to treat each other clearly as family? Some of you know, and I close with this, some years ago, this would be 1964, Second Presbyterian Church, like a lot of Southern dominantly white churches, prevented the NAACP and some other African-American folks from coming into our worship service. The rationale was, you're coming to protest instead of to worship. And I've often said, you know, if today we checked everybody's motives when they go to church, we wouldn't have many people in the sanctuary, I think. But they held them off at the door. It was a tragic moment in Second Presbyterian's history. Our pastor at the time was the little brother of Senator Richard Russell, who was the chairman of the Armed Services Committee of the Senate, U.S. Senate. And he was LBJ's biggest problem. And he said publicly, this is Richard Russell, there will be no amalgamation of the races in the South. That's what he said in 1964, while Jeb is pastoring Second Presbyterian Church. And this is going on. Well, eventually, you know, Richard Russell had about a 60-day filibuster, longest filibuster in the history of the Senate, but it eventually broke. And so did Jeb, the pastor. And Jeb opposed our whole session, or almost our whole session, and sent a letter to the congregation saying that this was wrong. It was a very courageous thing. You know, as pastors, you do something like that, you may as well pack your bags. Well, we lost 225 people because of it. So it was very costly, but it was the right thing to do. When I came to Second, I was aware of this history. And some of us said, John Adamson is right over here, he was with me in this, and we recruited everyone we could find in Memphis who had been turned down at the door. There were four people, and we met with them for a good while. And we just said to them, we just want to say to you, we're not apologizing because we weren't there. Although John was, and John opposed what was happening there, to his credit. So we didn't confess somebody else's sin, but we told them how sorry we were. One of those who was there was Dr. Maxine Smith, who for years became the president of the Memphis NAACP. Very distinguished woman. Her husband, Dr. Vasco Smith, was a local physician, and actually they were Presbyterians for a good while. And at one point, we gave Maxine Smith our statement at Second Presbyterian Church on racial justice, similar to the one that's being presented to you tomorrow. And we said, Dr. Smith, this is what we're looking at. Would you give us some feedback? She looked at that statement. She and Vasco, both of them, looked at it. And then she handed it back and she said, if you'll do this, you'll be fine. And I just want to say to this assembly, if you'll do what your statement says, if you pass anything close to it, if you'll just do that, you'll be fine. Let's remember the sad, lamentable history which we have received and participated in to some degree. Let's receive anew the lavish salvation given us in the union with Christ, in the atonement by his blood. And let's renew and revitalize the beautiful, loving society that Jesus Christ came to create for his glory. And after all, it is all about Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace toward us, for we would naturally go astray from you and from one another. In fact, it is indeed shameful how far astray we would go apart from you. But Lord, we're not astray. We're not apart from you. We're united to you. And with thanksgiving in our hearts, we plead with you to help us live out the implications of our lavish salvation, to reverse our lamentable history, and to begin to taste anew in fresh ways the meaning of this new society which you have miraculously created. May we see more and more of it and give more of ourselves to it in the days ahead. Praying in Jesus' name, amen.